composer's words, and the original words were, God is watching us, God is watching us from a distance. So if God to you is the universal kind of love and compassion, we're going to sing about and think of those words.
From a distance, the earth looks blue and green, and the snow-capped mountains white. From a distance, the ocean meets the stream, and the eagle takes to flight. From a distance, there is harmony, and it echoes through the land. It's the song of hope, it's the song of peace, it's the song of every man. From a distance, we all have enough, and no one is in need. And there are no guns, no bombs, no disease, no hungry mouths to feed. From a distance, there is harmony, and we're marching in a common band, singing songs of hope, singing songs of peace, singing songs of every man. We are sending light, we are sending love, we are sending hope from a distance. We are sending light, we are sending hope, we are sending love from a distance. From a distance, you look like my friend, even though we are at war. And there are no guns, no bombs, no disease, no hungry mouths to feed. From a distance, there is harmony, echoes through the land. It's the voice of hope, it's the voice of peace, it's the voice of every man. It's the voice of hope, it's the voice of peace, it's the voice of every man. We are sending light, we are sending love, we are sending peace from a distance. We are sending light, we are sending love, we are sending peace from a distance.
Constitution, Bill of Rights, First Amendment, and the entire selection is printed in your order of service, so I think we could read it together. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof.
Good morning. Today's reading is from an excerpt from a letter by Thomas Jefferson to the Danbury Baptist Association. Believing with you that religion is a matter which lies solely between man and his God, that he owes account to none other for his faith or his worship, that the legislative powers of government reach actions and not opinions, I contemplate with sovereign reverence the act of the whole American people, which declared that their legislature should make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, thus building a wall of separation between church and state. I would ask that we take a few moments to reflect on the significance of those words.
This morning's speaker is longtime ALUUC member Frank Kopecky. Frank is retired from the faculty of UIS, where he was director of the Legal Studies Program and taught constitutional law. Frank.
Once again. From time to time, I've been asked in the past to give a lecture or presentation on the state of the wall, and I used to do that. We used to do that pretty regularly over the summer when our minister wasn't in the pulpit. I haven't done that for a while, so I thought I would take the time to lay the groundwork and explain where the metaphor, the wall, comes from and its history and significance. Since I taught constitutional law, I've followed this issue very closely over the years, and I also have, in retirement, joined the Americans United for Separation of Church and State, which is a nonprofit organization that promotes the idea of separation of church and state. And I get its monthly newsletter, which has helped me keep abreast of this topic. So I'll try to briefly go through the background, and we'll try to accomplish three things. We'll look at what the language of that First Amendment means. We'll discuss the history and significance of the wall metaphor. And finally, we will look at the state of the wall as it exists today in 2019. The opening words of the Constitution Bill of Rights, which you read, thank you, Tina, Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of religion or the free exercise thereof, are also the opening words of the Bill of Rights. These words were put in there, I think, because of their significance to the founders, and I think they have continue to have meaning and significance today. Please note that the words "Congress shall make no law" is no longer really the law, because it should read "government shall make no law." Now, it's a long process by which the Bill of Rights were incorporated against the states and local government, and I don't have time to go into that now, but the Bill of Rights, the First Amendment, applies to every governmental unit in the United States, not only the federal government, Congress, but state governments, local governments, from the County Board of Sangamon to the Park District of Springfield, are governed by the First Amendment and its concept of freedom of religion. Simply put, the First Amendment basically says that Congress cannot interfere with one's belief. It can prevent actions, but it cannot interfere with one's belief, and it should not in any way unduly directly promote religion. The meaning of that it carries a great deal of significance. And many people think that Bill of Rights is anti-religious. Well, it isn't. One can believe whatever they want. They can be a believer of religion. They can be an atheist. They can have whatever they want. It guarantees freedom of conscience. and it is not anti-religious. The proof of that, in fact, is that the United States is probably one of the most religious countries in the world. We have more people attending churches than most of Western democracies, and we have more active church members than rest. So religion has flourished in the United States, largely because government has not interfered with it. Government has not forced it on people. People have accepted it voluntarily, and government also has not interfered with its development. The idea is not to oppose religion, but to separate it as much as possible from governing. Now, the words itself, as we read, come from Jefferson's letter to the Baptist Association. In it, he indicates that people have the right of conscience, and that government should not interfere with that right in any way. But one should not use government power to force one's beliefs upon others and to establish any type of church or religion. Therefore, there should be this wall separating the two. Jefferson and Madison and many of the other founders were really strong in their belief of separation of church and state. But actually, there's a reference in American history that uses the wall metaphor once again, and that was long before Jefferson. In 1636, Roger Williams, a Baptist theologian and founder of the Providence colony, which later became the state of Rhode Island, writing uses the wall metaphor. He argues that the church is like a garden and that the outside world, the political world, is like a wilderness, and the two should be separated by a wall. It's interesting that while Jefferson was concerned mostly about religion interfering with government, Roger Williams is, on the other hand, is concerned about government interfering with religion. Hence, there's a wall to keep government out of religion and a wall to keep religion out of government. The two should be separated. Well, why is this wall important? Why is this church and state important? Well, historically, one can look at the history of Europe and see the religious wars that raged throughout Europe during the 14th, 15th, and 16th century. The people were ravished between Catholic and Protestant faiths, and war was almost continuous. You have things like the 30-Year War, the 100-Year War. I'm not a great historian of that part of history, but just the names itself give a chill when you talk about a 100-Year War over religion. These people, the United States, after all, was an English colony. The English itself had its own conflicts between Protestant and Catholics. Now, many of us have watched the Elizabethan dramas on PBS or Masterpiece, where you have the conflict between Elizabeth and Mary, Queen of Scots, and all the intrigue and effort that went on. That seems like a drama to us, but to the founders, that was real history. This was their background. They also were aware of the English Civil War, with Cromwell marching through England and Ireland with Parliament Protestant armies ravishing the country. So the history of conflict generated by religion is one that the founders were quite aware of and put this language in the Constitution, I think, to avoid that. But there's also a deeper reason than that, a reason that may be more prevalent today, or important today, and that's the founders were trying to create a democracy. And for a democracy to work, you need a high level of tolerance. You need to accept the beliefs of others. You need to accept the decisions that are made. You need to reach compromise. You need to try to reach middle ground. And that's very, very hard to do if you're arguing with someone with who's coming from a doctrinaire religious position. So the idea was to try to keep religion as much as possible out of the political realm, to try to allow democracy to flourish in our country. I don't know if any of you have ever been in a discussion with a really religious person to try to find a middle ground on abortion. It's almost impossible. So I think they had that kind of thing in mind when they argued that let's try as much as possible to keep religion out of the political realm. And you can just look around the world today. You can look around the world today and look at countries that don't separate church and state, theology. Many of them are Muslim countries in the Middle East where you can be executed for insulting your religion. So that it's just the opposite of freedom of conscience. It's lack of conscience. You have no ability to criticize religion in any way. We don't want that happening in our country. Therefore, we strongly keep religion separated from church and state. But, and there's always a but, religion is an important part of our country. We're in a church today discussing it. There are churches all over the country. As the synagogues, mosques, Hindu temples, religious organizations of various kinds, as well as non-believers, various kinds that may be gathering this morning. We need to protect their rights as well as the rights of the majority. So the history, the democratic theory, and the fear of other places have led us to support the separation of church and state. But as I was saying, there's a but. And the but is that we can't really truly separate religion from the political life. After all, religion, political decisions are made on values, and religion has a role in forming those values. Also, on the other side of the coin, as this modern state has become more of a social welfare state, we have had more, there's more opportunity for interaction between religion and the political world. For many years, I was legal counsel for the Department of Children and Family Services, and we had to deal with various religious Catholic Protestant organizations who provided foster care for our children. Much of that still exists to this day. How do you I guess you could have a choice where everything would be public and you would have one big Department of Children and Family Services, or you could contract out to various not-for-profit organizations. Choices have to be made in that regard, and they have to be made in many ways. Just looking at, let me just go through some of the examples that the Supreme Court has grappled with. What if a community decided to give bus money, subsidized free bus money, for children to go to school? And they decided that that would be for both children who went to public school and private school. Would that violate the Constitution? Or would that be a secular support of transportation, allowing children to get to school? Actually, the Supreme Court ruled that that would be a secular use of public money to support children, not religion. Now, indirectly, religion is being supported. That can't be avoided. Another example is the municipality just recently decided to recycle. You've seen playgrounds where they have cut up tires and they put them on the ground for safety reasons. The municipality decided to have every playground in their city would be covered with this kind of recycled tire material, including playgrounds on religious schools. Does that violate the Constitution? Or is that just the necessary government use to protect children from damage? That case is now pending in the courts, actually, but the lower courts have ruled that that is a fair use of public money and is supporting children, not necessarily religion. Note that it was given to everybody. There was no preference there. It was both public and private children were being served. I've left this service a few times in the past, and driving down 2nd Street, I've noticed that the Sangamon County Sheriff is directing traffic from the Calvary Church across the road. Is that a violation of the Constitution? Probably not, because it's public safety. But yet, indirectly, it's helping to serve and promote and protect the persons who are going to that church. Well, those are just examples of the way that government and religion interacts. There's numerous ones. I think if one looks through the filings in court, there's probably as many court cases filed on separation of church and state as there are on other parts of the First Amendment. It's a very litigious topic, and people are always battling about how high or how low that wall should be. And that gets you, there's two sides of this debate. There's people who argue that that wall should be very, very high, that there should be almost a total separation of church and state. And there are others who argue that no, religion is part of our life scene. Churches, religious institutions are part of the environment, and we need to recognize their existence and not be hostile to them and allow certain public benefits to be directed their way as long as there's no preferential. Though people who take that position are generally called accommodationists. So there's this debate between the high wall separationists and the accommodationists, but it's largely a matter of degree. I don't think the most accommodationist person in the world is not arguing, or at least in the United States, is not arguing for a theocracy or to have direct funding of religious service, particularly services that are having to do with the theology of an organization. So this debate goes on. It's gone on probably since the beginning of the Republic, as to just how much should government involve itself with religion and how much should it stay out. So it's not a total separation. This wall has never been a total separation. It's a matter of degree, how high that wall should be or how low that wall should be. Now, I hope I sort of summarized a lot of constitutional theory in 10 or 15 minutes. I hope I didn't bore you, and I hope that made the point a little bit. So let's go to the state of the wall right now. I've been, one advantage of being older is that I've looked at this issue for over 50 years, probably the first time in undergraduate constitutional law, and I've followed it fairly closely over that time. And in my lifetime, I've seen the United States Supreme Court go from a court in which the majority of the court were high wall separationists to a court in which the accommodationists are clearly in control. The Ruth Bader Ginsburg is probably the last, and Justice Kagan are the last two really high wall separationists on the court. Oftentimes they're joined by Justices Sotomayor and Breyer, but the other five, Alito, Justice Thomas, Justice Gorsuch, those are clearly in the accommodationist court, and probably they're leaning more to really favoring support of religion. Justice Kavanaugh is an unknown. Justice Roberts is somewhat in the middle, but he leans mostly with the accommodationist side. So the Supreme Court is very much a 5-4 accommodationist court. Now, the problem with that is that religion, that we have an administration, the Trump administration, who is being encouraged by supporters on the religious right to take some very drastic steps to encourage government support of religion and to advance the idea of free exercise of religion. In doing that, they're passing regulations in various code departments. The Department of Health and Human Services, for example, has issued regulations which would allow people to discriminate based on religious organizations to discriminate based on belief and gender and discriminate against LGBTQ people. The Betsy Voss in the Department of Education is actively promoting voucher programs for federal money going to public private schools, mostly of religious nature. The HHS regulations have threatened the ability of reproductive rights of women by giving persons, on the basis of their perceived religious liberty, but if they believe, for example, that contraception or abortion is religiously wrong, and that's a religiously held belief, they can deny services to that individual. Regulations are being proposed just to do that. In fact, they went into effect. Most of these regulations are being challenged in court by a variety of organizations, including the Americans United for Separation of Church and State, the American Humanist Association. I noticed the UUA has joined in some of these suits. But the rub, of course, is, and the lower courts are basically ruling in favor of stopping these regulations. But eventually, they're going to work their way up to the United States Supreme Court. And I'm not optimistic when they get there. But that may be a several-year process. So in the interim, there's things that perhaps we could do. But let's look at a couple of recent Supreme Court opinions and see how the accommodationist has won. And I might say that, you know, these aren't evil people. I tend to have some accommodationist thoughts personally, but then I'm a Unitarian Universalist, and I can't think of a more tolerant, open-minded group, but I have to remember that other religions aren't quite that way, that they're more doctrinaire, that they insist on their positions, that they're not tolerant of different beliefs. The case I want to bring up is a case decided just, you know, last June, the so-called Brandenburg Peace Cross case, which involved a large Christian cross, 20 to 30 feet tall, on a public traffic, actually a traffic circle in the state of Maryland, right outside Washington, D.C., on the road that leads to Annapolis. The American Humanist Association brought a lawsuit challenging the government support of that religious symbol, and it's a large religious symbol. The Supreme Court ruled in a 7-2 decision, with Ginsburg and Kagan being the only two dissenters, that did not violate the Establishment Clause. Now, the reasoning is kind of interesting, and it gives one some hope. The reasoning is that the cross itself, although a Christian symbol, was put up not so much to support religion, but as a symbol of valor for those who died in World War I. The Peace Cross was put up in 1922, I believe, or somewhere in that period. And it was to dedicated to the memory and the lives lost of U.S. Soldiers overseas in the World War I conflict. And the court reasoned that the symbol was one that reflected the same type of crosses you'd see on fields in Flanders or France, and therefore represented to the families and the whose loved ones they're commemorating a symbol of valor and military service, not so much Christianity. Now, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, as dissent base, says that's hogwash. It's a Christian symbol, but nevertheless, the court majority reasons this way and also pointed out, and I think this is really important, that cross had been there since 1922 and it had historic significance. If it were torn down or removed, you would create the very religious conflict, the conflict with religion that we're trying to avoid by having separation church and state. So therefore they allowed it to stand. Now the good news about that opinion, and if you look at the opinion, say, on the crosses on public buildings or the Ten Commandments on Capitol grounds, is that I think the court is going to continue to rule that any new religious symbol that's put up for a religious, to sort of symbolize religion, is going to be struck down, but if they're historic, they're going to be likely to stay. So Justice Breyer, I think, wrote a very strong concurring opinion to that effect. And that's probably the reason why Justice Sotomayor and Breyer joined with the majority to allow this to happen so that those words could get into the opinion. So making distinction between historic use of religious symbols as opposed to new use of religious symbols. The other case I like to raise up is the so-called Masterpiece Case. This is a case out of Colorado, Masterpiece Cake case. This is a case out of Colorado in which a baker refused to bake a cake for a gay couple who were going to engage in a gay marriage, a same-sex marriage. The Colorado Civil Rights Commission ruled that against the baker and fined that baker for violating discrimination laws of the state of Colorado. The appellate court supported that decision. It got to the Supreme Court, and it lost in a 7-2 decision. This was last year. That's the bad news. The good news is some of us feared that the court would follow the reasoning of the case involving I got a mental block in the name. What's the Hobby Lobby? There we go. On the Hobby Lobby case, in which the Supreme Court allowed the owner of Hobby Lobby, which incidentally is a corporation, but it's a closely held corporation, had a strongly held religious belief against the use of contraception and abortion. The Affordable Care Act requires as a preventive measure that all insurance policies include the ability of persons to receive contraception, including certain types of contraception which could be considered abortifacients, such as the morning after pill. The Supreme Court ruled in that case that their religious liberty, the religious liberty of this person, superseded the rights of the gay couple, and therefore the rights of the woman who was seeking, the employees of this corporation, to have an insurance policy with that included those preventative measures, and therefore struck down a portion of the Affordable Care Act or the Obamacare. The fear was that reasoning, the idea that you have a religious liberty right to discriminate against a state democratically imposed decision to prevent discrimination against a certain class of individuals, in this case, people seeking gay marriage, that this court would use that same reasoning to against the couple that was seeking the wedding cake. Now the good news is the Supreme Court didn't do that. They used the more technical grounds, saying that the Civil Rights Commission of Colorado, in its reaching its decision, demonstrated hostility to religion and therefore was not an impartial decision maker, and therefore reversed the decision of the Colorado Civil Rights Commission on the grounds that they showed a bias against the individual, not treating him fairly in a procedural way. So that's a very, very narrow decision. However, I'm not sure that's a really strong read to rest upon, because working its way through the court system is a very similar case involving flowers for a gay marriage. And that may get to the Supreme Court next year. We'll see. But, you know, I don't want to leave on a total negative note here. Courts have a way of working slowly and following the spirit of the times, the zeitgeist of the times. Thus far, they've held although accommodationists are in the forefront, they have not been as drastic as I feared, but the future, who knows? But here's the good news. The major threat to church and state right now is not necessarily the Supreme Court. The court, after all, is a reactionary organization. It reacts to other government entities. The real threat to separation church and state right now are all these governmental regulations being put forward by the Trump administration, which are being challenged in court. And the good news is, from a perspective of a citizen, we have a chance to change that. There's going to be an election in a year. If you're concerned about separation of church and state, take that in consideration when you vote. I'm very concerned about that. I think all of us should be. The Supreme Court is leaning strongly towards an accommodationist view. Therefore, it's almost essential from a church and state perspective that we change the perspective of the government of the United States, who are pushing out these regulations. I think I've probably used up all my time, but if people have questions, I'll try to respond. Yes, sir.
So, in healthcare, most of your hospitals and health systems are religious, and with Medicare being the primary payer to hospitals, what is your opinion on that? Medicare being government funds.
That's a good example. I don't know if people heard, the question was, Medicare gives a lot of money to religious organizations. Is that a violation of the Constitution? I can't give you the specific case, but I know that case has been litigated, and the answer is no, that's allowable under the Constitution. Yes, Dan.
Yes, Frank. Wonderfully done, I might add. I tell you what, we have had a lot of cases here lately where the religious beliefs of the CEO seem to trump. I said that deliberately.
I try to avoid that word.
The religious beliefs of the line rats, you know, because the CEO doesn't like contraception, then the women can't get it. Or, on the other hand, you get these organizations, supposedly do-gooder organizations, that basically say, God says we are to beat the Ten Commandments into the kids, or deny them basic maintenance medications and so forth. How do we keep the freedom, including the freedom of religion, of the powerless, shall we say, pretty much on an even keel with that of some male CEO denying contraception?
Well, that's exactly the facts of the Hobby Lobby case. And that's why I find that case disturbing. I think, the metaphor of a wall where government should stay out of religion, or government shouldn't, religion shouldn't stay in out of government, or government should stay out of religion, it sort of fails in that instance, because religion is being used almost as a sword going out of the wall to attack. Saying that a CEO of a major corporation says that he has a strong religious belief, so therefore you can deny insurance benefits to all your employees. I think that decision is wrong, but that is the decision of the Supreme Court. We're going to have to work on, we're going to have to wait for a new Supreme Court to change it. Now, what I fear is that that decision could be limited to the fact that the person was concerned about four contraceptive techniques, drugs, that some people would consider being an abortion. And therefore, you could limit it to that and try to work beyond that. But that's the real risk, Dan. You've put your finger on the real risk. Yes, Kurt. Many states have built into their laws accommodations for religious conscience. Most of those laws require that if you like the pharmacist who feels strongly about not providing a certain drug, they have to have some alternative, like somebody else in the department can distribute that drug, or there has to be an alternative outside, another drugstore within a reasonable distance to do that. If not, then usually those laws have been struck down. But here's the difference between the two. In that case, it was a democratically organization that thinking about the need to accommodate religion, made this accommodation. It wasn't an individual saying, my religious freedom trumps, using Dan's word, your right to be not discriminated, or not to have that drug, and the court recognizing that. So I think that's a distinction that is important, but I think if we're going to have these kind of religious exceptions, they have to be drawn narrowly, and there have to be ways around them. Yes?
Years ago, when I was a child, growing up in a Christian Science family, we had religious exemptions on vaccinations. Since this goes back pretty far from my age, I had already had childhood measles. I didn't have a smallpox vaccination, but of course that's pretty well wiped out. As I look back on the religion and the people, they're much more flexible and not as adamant or as far as vaccinations go. The underlying belief being the most loving thing for the public might be to go ahead and accept the vaccination. It's not going to hurt.
Right.
But now we have had anti-vax people. In New York, I think it has been, and with Orthodox Jewish people.
Right.
And I was thinking that the state law overruled, and they had to take vaccine. They had to at least be quarantined. And I'm thinking they may have to take vaccinations. Is that the case? And how far is that going?
Increasingly, many states have had for years exceptions for religious belief for vaccinations. The trend now is for at least states like California, New York, to eliminate those kind of exceptions. The reason, of course, is vaccination. I don't fully understand this, but unless everybody is vaccinated, it's a danger to those, to people who cannot be vaccinated for various reasons. Pardon me?
Herd immunity,
which I don't quite understand, but we'll leave it at that. So the trend is for legislatures to pass laws overriding the religious beliefs in that case. And of course, you know, that they'll be challenged, and we'll see how courts deal with it. Yeah. All right, Larry, last question. That's correct. Okay. You remember the opening words? Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of the religion or free exercise thereof. That's two clauses. The first part is what's known as the Establishment Clause, and the second part is what's known as the Free Exercise Clause. People that are pushing the idea of religious liberty are operating under the Free Exercise Clause. Now, there's a tension between the two. If you go too strong in the direction of free exercise, then you're establishing, you can be accused of establishing religion. If you go too far prohibiting or accommodating religion, you can be accused of being hostile to religion. The two are in somewhat of a tension. The cases that Dan mentioned, the Hobby Lobby case, and some of the cases that are coming up now where religion is being used as a sword, are under the Free Exercise Clause. People are saying, I have a right to conscience, and my conscience is so strong, my religious beliefs are so strong, that a generally enacted public act cannot apply to me because of those religious beliefs. And there's tension there. I remember when I was with legal DCFS, we would remove, we had children whose parents, because of their religious beliefs, didn't want to engage in certain medical treatments. These treatments were life-saving. The state had to step in and take guardianship of these children. These were debatable. I mean, people have the right to exercise, their parental rights, you have the state in the hand of public health. Somebody has to make these decisions, and the decision was made that life is more important than the parents' religion at that point. That's not an easy decision to make. I remember sweating through some of those decisions. But the law needs that, same way with vaccination. And the case that Dan mentioned, how much as a society should we recognize people's right of conscience they can stop duly elected laws that are generally apply to the general public, have a secular purpose of protecting public health or public safety, and allow those people to develop their own exceptions. Now, the example Kurt made, the distinction there, of course, is that's the legislative body making that exception, not the individual based on religious freedom. It's the legislative body, the democratically elected body, through a democratic process, making that exception, not the individual who's claiming religious liberty. Does that help, Larry? I hope. All right, that's it.